So I'm very pleased and very happy and honored, actually, to be here for the celebration of my good friend Samson's 60th. Before going to the, you know, I don't know when I really met face to face Samson. Again, he has been part of the landscape, I think, forever. But I, as usual in our field, you meet people through the archives before you actually see their faces, or since these were pre-archived dates, through preprints. I think I was at CERN when I first started, you know, looking at papers written by Samson and company, and they looked terribly uninteresting to me at the time. So, you know, quantizing quadjoint orbits of the Virasoro algebra, Eric talked about it. I didn't know what they were doing, why they were doing it. It was totally of the mark, and then, you know, it got worse before it got better. Here is, for instance, the next bunch of papers of Samson and company. If you just look at the title, Vesumino-Witten model as a theory of free fields, multi-loop calculations, this makes no sense, right? What kind of free fields with multi-loop calculations are you talking about? Actually, you would notice also that not only the understanding of the Vesumino-Witten model, but probably also English grammar was regressing, because for reasons that I never understood, the first title had Vesumino-Witten all in capital, and then in the second paper, just a week later, Zumino and Witten were relegated to lowercase letters, but everything else was a capital.
But I can tell so you that I also complained.
Now, in any case, the first paper I really read was the one that Eric talked about on background-independent open string field theory. That was a great paper, very inspiring one. And by that time, I had also met Samson, so I knew that he was a great guy with lots of nice ideas, and that he was also a very gifted person in all sorts of ways. Indeed, trying to think a little during these days about what else Samson could have done, you know, there's a landscape of Samsons. And of course, there is our universe where he's a great physicist, but apparently he could equally well have been a champion of tennis, a champion of chess, I'm told, a champion, a top violin player, you know, even some less recommended options like this one. But I was wondering whether there's also a Samson swampland. Now, there is no Sam. I couldn't find you know, anything. I mean, Samson is not going to tell you that he won't be able to do something at the top level. So I was looking at all possible sources. The most reliable source was Nina, so I had to ask her. So she found one entry in a swampland, you know, which is apparently singing. So apparently Samson cannot sing, even though he's a violin player. I had a less reliable also option, namely my conjecture was that Samson cannot cook, because I have never seen him eat anything but red meat. So, but this may actually be a wrong entry in the swampland. So I, you know, I encourage you to all try to find entries in this, because it's the other way around from quantum gravity. You know, in quantum gravity, the swampland is huge, and there are few entries in the landscape. Here it seems to be the opposite. So Samson, happy birthday, and I will now move to my talk, which is, so it's a subject that has interested me for a number of years now, multi-metric or multi-gravity theories, and let me simply tell you what the story is. There would be a talk by Gregory Gabadadze later in this conference, who will talk much more about multimetric theories and massive gravity. But basically the question is the following. You are given two metric universes, so you have two metrics. I'll use the notation of lower and uppercase letters for the two universes. Now the manifolds are diffeomorphic, so there is also some mapping of the coordinates from here to there. you start with two decoupled guys, so they have independent Einstein actions, independent Planck scales, independent cosmological terms, and more generally matters coupling to little g or capital G. But now if you have this diffeomorphism, you can of course also write down potentially new couplings, which include g mu nu at little x and the pullback of the capital g mu nu, gmn back to this manifold. So with these two metrics, you can make diffeo-invariant couplings. And we are interested in a situation where the coefficient of this kind of couplings is very small in a way to be made precise. So the question is, does this make sense? And can you actually compute things with it? Now, let me say very briefly, since I think Gregory will talk much more about it, just a few comments about what was known and what is known. I think the first people to talk about these possibilities, namely a theory which has two diffeo invariances, and it was called FG gravity, and the name has stuck even today, was Isham, Salam, and Stradi about 50 years ago now. And what happens is that for generic interaction Lagrangian, the spectrum includes a massless graviton and a second massive spin two field. So the two metrics, the two metric fluctuations, they mix like in a double well potential. One of them stays massless, the other becomes massive. The mass is typically of the order of this parameter mu square. I'm assuming the coupling here is non-derivative in the metrics, by the way, for reasons that I'm not explaining here. So mu has dimensions of mass. The mass of the graviton is of this form. And in general, there is a ghost when you do this. A quick way to understand why is that this field, which will become the Stueckelberg field, xm of little x, this field that restores reparametrization symmetries on both sides, has the three missing polarizations of the massive graviton plus a fourth one, and the fourth one is typically a ghost. And very nice progress on this question has been made after many years of efforts in these papers of Deram, Gabadadze et al. And Hassan and Rosen, who showed that there is a special three-parameter family of couplings, of interactions, in which, at least classically, the ghost drops out. Now, two more remarks. First of all, if you think about bigravity, you also think automatically about massive gravity. There is a very simple limit. You just take one of the Planck scales to infinity, the fluctuations of one metric freeze out, decouple, and then you are just left with a massive graviton. So massive gravity is just a special limit of this bimetric theory. We don't have to think about it independently. But the second interesting fact is that this effective theory, obviously it's an effective theory, breaks down much before the Planck scale. Actually, it breaks down at an intermediate scale called lambda 3 in this literature, and which is basically some geometric mean of the mass of the graviton and the Planck scale. And this was first pointed out in this very nice paper of Arkanihan et al. And there is much more work later. Okay, now, of course, before going into what I will tell you about, the real important question for a physicist is whether such effective field theory is compatible with the real world physics, in particular tests of GR and early cosmology. And this includes understanding the Weinstein mechanism. I won't say anything about this in this talk. Let me simply say that LIGO and Virgo quote now an upper bound on the mass of the graviton, which is about one kilo light years, if I remember correctly. And of course, if the mass is smaller than the horizon scale, then it's hard to imagine its impact on phenomenology. I have nothing to say about this, so I won't talk about this. This talk will be just restricted to the formal question, can multigravity arise from a UV complete theory, string theory? Is it part of the landscape or the swampland? And I will answer this in the positive, namely this part of the landscape, but with some twists. Indeed, the subject was revived actually from bottom-up approaches to embed brain world models in higher dimensions. So it was two influential papers were the Randall-Sundrum and the DGP, gravity. There's this paper that I will mention a little later by Thibault and Kogan. One problem with all these bottom-up approaches was very simple. The brains had to be heavy enough to back-react and change the spectrum of the graviton. But when they are heavy enough to back-react, they are never thin. So the approximations were not valid, even though the generic ideas were interesting, inspiring. So what I will tell you about is work with my student, Ioannis Lavdas, my former student. Now he's a postdoc who is in the room, in the audience. As you will see, there are no brains in the end of the story, and one should really talk about weakly coupled flux universes. So that's in the way of introduction, and now, is there any question before I go on? So I'll change gear now and just talk about the same problem from the dual holographic side. So we know that now we can think about IHES gravity as CFT. So what's the question on the CFT side? Now the question is very simple to phrase. So the energy momentum tensor of the conformal field theory is the operator dual to the graviton. Its dimension is related to the mass of the graviton through this formula where d is the dimension of the CFT. I will go to d equals to 3 later in the talk so as to talk about four-dimensional gravity. There is one other quantity which one can call the central charge, even though it's not doesn't play the same role in higher dimensions, and which is the normalization of the two-point function of the energy momentum tensor, C, and the dual quantity is simply the Planck scale in units of the IHES radius to some power. Okay, that's the dictionary, and we also know that if the energy momentum tensor is conserved, this means that its canonical, its scaling dimension is canonical, it's D, and automatically this gives a massive graviton. So to get anything like a massless graviton, so to get a massive graviton, you need somehow energy momentum tensor to leak out of the CFT. Okay, there's no way you can get it if the energy momentum tensor is conserved. This equation must have a right-hand side, which is a vector, and this vector is precisely the Stueckelberg that, whose role was played, remember, by the change of coordinates between the two universes. Okay, so the question then we want to ask is the following. Suppose we have two conformal field theories. They have semi-classical gravity duals. They are decoupled. They have independent Lagrangians. Now we want to add some coupling, delta L, and that will be, of course, the question, which will make them coupled weakly in the sense that the graviton will just obtain a very tiny mass. Okay, that's the question. So, as I said, if delta L is zero, then the two energy momentum tensors are separately conserved. There are two massless gravitons, two decoupled universes. If the coupling is weak, but in a way that has to be qualified, then you look at the two linear combinations. There is the total energy momentum tensor. It's still conserved. And I have here normalized it so that the two-point function is one. And there is the orthogonal combination, which can acquire some anomalous scaling dimension and which is not conserved. This means that there is exchange of energy momentum tensor between the two theories. So what I mean by weak is that this anomalous scaling dimension epsilon has to be much, much less than one, actually parametrically smaller than one. It has to be able to go to zero. And at the same time, all other spin two operators must have dimensions that are separated from this by a gap. Okay. Otherwise, there is no point. We shouldn't even call this multigravity. I want a situation where there is only one light graviton, a gap, and then eventually Kaluza-Klein or other, or multiparticle bound states. So that's the definition of what we mean by weakly coupled CFTs. Now you notice that I told you before that massive gravity is a special case. You see it immediately in this formula. If you take the big Planck scale or the big central charge to infinity, formally this operator goes to zero, whereas this operator goes formally simply to the little tij, and which now has an anomalous dimension. Okay, so this is simple. Now when you think about coupling the two CFTs, there are two ways you can do it. The first was considered in the mid-2000s by Kiritsis and Aharoni, Clark and Karch, and they did the obvious thing. They said, well, let's take an operator from theory one, multiply it by an operator from theory two. If we are lucky, this could be a marginal coupling, so lambda can be arbitrarily small. So that's a way to try to do it. There are many buts in this. The first one is that this, being a double trace operator, is down by powers of 1 over n in the large n expansion. This means essentially that it's a quantum effect in gravity, so you have to really go to quantum gravity to see it. But more seriously, there is a second place where this idea doesn't fly, namely double trace couplings. What do you make of them in string theory? We know that from Witten's prescription that in gravity they correspond to modified boundary conditions in ADS or an alternative quantization, but there is no string theory rule for what it means to make this coupling, to turn on this coupling. So in a sense there is, from the very start, no real string theory embedding. You are at best doing supergravity. Up to now, maybe this will change, and I will have a comment on this later on. Be it as it is, Aharoni et al. Did do a calculation. They said, well, we can just do conformal perturbation theory, assuming lambda is marginal. They did a very nice calculation and obtained epsilon as a number that I didn't even write down, lambda squared times 1 over the central charge of theory 1 plus 1 over the central charge of theory 2. And you will see that this same type of formula will arise, but differently in our problem. What we did was something different, but which turns out to be much more controllable. Well, instead of putting a double trace operator, so here are the two CFTs. Now, I write, for those of you that are not in the subject, the quiver is simply some way to encode the information of a gauge theory. So circles are gauge groups, squares are fundamental matter representations. Never mind, this is some normal gauge field theory. This is the same one. I assume that they have a common global symmetry, which then you gauge. So in a sense, by gauging a common global symmetry, you insert a mediator, a messenger, which makes the two theories communicate. Now, if this messenger were weakly coupled, or maybe, as you will see, if the rank of this gauge group is very small, there is a chance that the energy leaking between the two is small, and that's what we will calculate. Actually, the leaking of energy and the corresponding anomalous scaling dimension will be small. So that's...
They live in the same space or they touch at the boundary?
They live in the same space here. Yeah. Flat space, right? I mean, here the CFTs are just in flat space. Yeah. There's no gravity in the CFTs, that's just CFT.
Everything back from the second copy to the first copy, is that what you've done?
So. That was done in the gravity side, okay. Now I'm... So in the gravity, I need to take one manifold to the other to write down a local coupling, right?
I was just wondering if you had two times and two, as well as two operators, two sets of operators.
Well, you have two diffeomorphic manifolds, but in the end of the day, think of living in just one. So the other guy is somewhere else, you know, it's some hidden sector, but not hidden in the usual sense of the word, hidden also from gravity, I mean, it's somewhere else. Okay, now, as you will see, what this allows us to do is, first of all, to treat things classically in gravity, no quantum effects, and to embed things in string theory in a very controllable manner. Okay, so that's what I will show to you, but before even starting, one can do some very simple, you know, some almost freelance representation theory. Can this be possible? How can the graviton obtain a mass? Given that we also will add some supersymmetry to make, as usual in string theory, things controllable. Well, let me tell you a few things about some kind of algebraic constraints or classificational num in the same way that num classified conformal field theories. First of all, you know, particle states in anti-de Sitter are representations of the conformal group, of course. The conformal group has the rotation group and the U1 or R in the covering space, which plays the role of scaling dimension or energy. And the representations that enter are always highest weight. So in three dimensions, we need to specify basically the spin S and the scaling dimension delta under the conformal group for the lowest weight states. And the corresponding infinite unitary representation I will denote by S delta, so spin and scaling dimension. The massless particles for spin bigger than a half, 0.5 are special, have scaling dimension S plus 1. So for S equals 2, the graviton, this is delta equals to 3, remember. This is then a short representation, basically the conservation law of the corresponding current. Truncates, gives null states, so truncates the representation. Now, Porati pointed out in 2001 and 3 that the Higgsing of a gauge symmetry in gravity is the same as the breaking of a global symmetry in the conformal field theory, and the way this works is simply by recombining short representations into a long one. So, in particular, the short graviton multiplet together with a short Stuckelberg multiplet can recombine into a long graviton multiplet. So for spin 2, this means that you take the massless spin 2 graviton, a massive vector, which plays the role of a Stuckelberg, and together they give a massive graviton. Okay, that's simply recombination. Now, if you have supersymmetry, you just super everything, so the group is super conformal. In three dimensions, SO23 becomes OSP4N, where N is now the number of supersymmetries. And now we are lucky that all unitary highest weight representations of all supergroups have been very nicely compiled in this work of Cordova, Dumitrescu, and Intrilligator, based on a lot of previous work. So many special cases were known before, but they have put everything very conveniently and nicely in a nice article. So we just look at these representations. In particular, the graviton would be now a spin 2 supermultiplet, the Stuckelberg fields, a Stuckelberg supermultiplet, which always includes spin 3.5 states, actually. And it should be possible for the two to combine into a long spin 2 representation. You inspect the tables and you see that in some cases the energy momentum tensor representation is just absolutely protected, never appears in the right hand side of the decomposition of a long representation. This happens when the dimension of the CFT is bigger than 4 and when the number of supersymmetries is more than half maximal, actually. So in these cases, massive gravity is just excluded. That's just kinematics. So this rules out certain cases, not always obvious. Here is a table, but for instance, there is no massive gravity with n equal 5 or higher supersymmetries in ADS4, just for kinematic reasons. Now, what's allowed in principle is therefore four-dimensional gravity with less than 4 supersymmetries or equal, And five-dimensional gravity with less or equal than two supersymmetries. And in both cases, you can easily show that the gauge mediator mechanism can be applied, and in both cases, therefore, these bounds are saturated. So there are existence proofs, and here I will show you explicitly the upper example. You have to do a little more work to see what the double trace couplings can do, and it turns out that double trace couplings that have to be relevant or marginal, of course, otherwise they go away, are only allowed with one quarter supersymmetry, so they are more restricted than the weak gauging. And this, I won't describe this, you can see it in this recent preprint of last year. Basically, you can just show that if you take the tensor product of two superfields and you look for top components, these would be supersymmetric deformations that are relevant or marginal. There are none if there is more than one quarter supersymmetry. So here then are the allowed cases. In a sense, massive ADS5 gravity with half maximal supersymmetry and massive ADS4 gravity with again half maximal supersymmetries are the two maximal situations by analogy with again NAMM's six-dimensional superconformal symmetry. And those are the two I want to concentrate on.
Are there relations between them? I mean, usually, like complexification or whatever.
It's a good point, so I'll make a comment in the end on this, yeah. Let me simply show you very explicitly the Higgsing of the N equal 4 four-dimensional supergraviton. As I said, you have the graviton multiplet. It has 16 bosonic states. It has six vectors, two scalars, and the graviton. The Stuckelberg guy has 112 bosonic degrees of freedom. It includes four gravitini, actually. And if you combine the two, you make a long multiplet which has exactly the same content as the N equal 8 maximal supergravity. So the long massive multiplet we are talking about seems to be in the same field space as the maximal supergravity of Kremer and Julia. And we can show indeed that it can be obtained at threshold by gauging N equals 8, but only at threshold. There's no obvious way, we work on this with Severin Luist, of trying to go further and deform it to make this long multiplet massive. That's a side remark. Now I want to show to you how you embed this into string theory, but are there any questions on this before? Yes.
But this recombination is a continuous process, right?
Yes.
But here you don't have a continuous parameter. So what?
Hold on, so you will see. So I will have a continuous parameter and I will also have a parametrically small parameter, a rational number essentially, which can be made.
Yeah, you can make a rational number, but you can never make it continuous. I mean, it's the rational.
Yeah, but it doesn't matter. At the level of recombination of representations, it doesn't matter. The excluded cases are cases where there is a mass gap of one. And there is no way with a parametrically small deformation that you can make. Yeah. Okay, so let me show you now the embedding in string theory. So, as I say, I will consider the two maximally supersymmetric allowed cases. There is some quiver gauge theory on one side, another one on the other side. We gauge a common global symmetry. And now the two cases were either d equal 4 and equal 2 on the CFT, or d equal 3 and equal 4. Okay. Now, d equal 4 and equal 2 sounds like the simpler one. And
this total quiver theory, now you have this one big quiver theory.
It's a total quiver now, exactly. But somewhere in the middle, there is a weak link that I want to break.
That quiver is also superconformal.
Yes,
the entire thing is
superconformal. The entire thing. I don't go away from anti-de Sitter, yeah.
Well, does it seem to have a weak link? Like the gauge coupling is weak, or what?
So, hold your horses. So, indeed, in four dimensions, one would say there's an obvious way to decouple things. The gauge coupling can be marginal. Just take it continuously to zero, the two things decouple.
But then you don't have an ADS dual.
But the problem is, indeed, that I don't have now an ADS dual, a geometric dual, so it's some quantum phenomenon which I cannot control. Now, in three-dimensional field theory or four-dimensional gravity, things are more, fortunately, more favorable. Now, here you think you start with a less controllable situation. The three-dimensional gauge coupling is, of course, massive, flows to infinity in the infrared. And yet, as I will show to you, the leaking of energy momentum tensor can be parametrically small because of two other parameters that would come in. So this is the example that we know how to control. This one, we don't. And there is work in progress, but we don't.
On that one, actually, the four-dimensional one, there are a bunch of, I mean, this is the superconformal total theory, right?
Yes.
There are a bunch of gauge couplings there.
Yes.
You can play games.
Yeah, but the real game is here. In a sense, you have somewhere to cut the thing in two and stop the exchange of energy.
How this place is distinguished at where?
Okay, you are rushing ahead, but in a sense, you know, if you think about what can happen, how can this be distinguished? A, the gauge coupling could be weak, but then we are away from semi-classical gravity. B, and that's what I will use, the rank of the gauge group can be very small. So there are very few degrees of freedom that are involved in the exchange compared to the semi-classical gravity. Now, in four dimensions, that's impossible. You can easily show that the ranks of the gauge groups along the quiver are a convex function, so it can never be weak. In three, it can, and I will use it. But then there is a third parameter that you cannot see from what I draw, and which will come into here, which allows us again to tune continuously, actually, the thing to zero. So anyway, this, even though it looks the harder case, is the controllable one. This is still to be worked out.
Sorry, so the idea is to take the rank to be small?
I will take the rank to be small and the second parameter that I will explain now.
Okay. Small, then the gauge coupling is again weak. It's the same as in 4D.
No, it's three-dimensional gauge.
But, I mean, still the gauge coupling is going to be weak. It's like the Applequist limit of large and F and three-dimensional gauge theory with large and F. They don't have a gravity dual.
Okay, so you will see that there is, hold on. I mean, it's the ratio of ranks that enters. So, of course, I want to stay with gravity dual. So, okay, now let me tell you about the geometry. I have told you about field theory. Now, the reason why we can control all this is because there is a huge class of n equal 4 holographic dual pairs that are pretty much well understood now. On the CFT side, they were conjectured to exist by Guy Otto-Witten, never mind about the details of the theory, so they are the so-called good quiver theories in three dimensions. Good means essentially that you can completely, there are enough matter fields to totally Higgs the whole gauge symmetry. This gives you some constraints on the quiver data. And the dual geometries are known exactly analytically. First, their local form in a very nice paper on classical integrability by the UCLA group, Docker, Estes, Good, Perl, and then the global constraints and the exact mapping in a later work of Assel, Estes, Gomis, and myself. So we know exactly the map, and that's why we could work this thing out. I won't show you the formulae again, you can find them in papers. Let me just make a few comments. One is that there are no continuous free parameters in these theories. All the data is in the discrete numbers of the quiver, the ranks of the gauge groups, and the dimensions of the fundamental representations. Or equivalently, on the gravity side, they are all in quantized brain charges, so no continuous parameters, but a precise one-to-one map on the two sides. So I won't discuss this in any detail. However, I just want to show to you what is relevant for my purposes today. The metric, let me tell you about the metric on the gravity side. Well, symmetry dictates almost the generic form. You know, it has to have an ADS4, that's the conformal group. It's n equal 4, so there should be an SO4 isometry, and this is realized by two spheres. So this is, in a sense, fixed by symmetry, and the whole thing, of course, we are in 10 dimensions, that's string theory. So it has to be fibered over some Riemann surface, sigma. And the way the solutions work out, so the metric is of this form. There is the ADS metric. There is the transverse space, which has this particular form, 2-2 spheres fibered over a Riemann surface. The Riemann surface will be a disk topologically. And there is a warp factor, e to the 2a, which is simply the scale, the radius of ADS that can vary as you go around sigma. It turns out, I won't show to you, the geometry is totally determined by 5 brain singularities at the boundaries of this disk. The boundaries of the disk are not boundaries of the geometry, right? They are boundaries of the parametrization of the geometry. So the geometry, of course, has no boundary. But 5 brain singularities totally fix this geometry in terms of 2 positive harmonic functions on sigma. So I won't say more on this. Just believe me.
And the size of the 6 extra dimension is small compared to the radius of ADS 4?
No. So you will see this. Yes. So what is the decoupling limit we are interested in? So remember, in the field theory, somehow naively, we want to take small rank for the mediating gauge symmetry, but still stay semi-classical. So the rank is large, but much smaller than something that the ranks of the two blobs on the two sides. Anyway, since we know the dictionary with Yannis, we just worked out the fact that, as you expect, there's no other degeneration limit. The degeneration limit is to split the singularities in 2 parts, pinch the Riemann surface in the middle, and then find the geometry like the one I show here. So here is the geometry. Basically, the left half is some ADS4 compactification of string theory. The right half is some other ADS4 compactification. I keep with the notation of lower and uppercase letters for the two. And what is in between, what is this gauge mediation geometrically? Well, it turns out to be a very well-known solution. It's called the Janus throat. It's a deformation of ADS5 cross S5 geometry that I will tell you a few things more about. So this is the degeneration limit in the gravity side. And let me here comment. So there was this paper of Thibault and Ian Coggan. It didn't have too many results, but it was a very lucid description of what can happen. Sorry, Thibault, but I think you agree. No, it was very helpful for me, at least, for understanding things, because that was early times of localized gravity and multigravity. Thibault and Ian Coggan asked the question, under what conditions can we find a spectrum like the one I want, namely a massless and a very slightly massive graviton, a gap, and then further states? Well, they point out that that's impossible if the internal manifold is Ricci flat. And then they make the comment that there is a Chigger bound on the eigenvalues of the Laplacian. It's a very nice bound. It tells you that the lowest mass or eigenvalue is bigger than the infimum of the following thing. You cut the manifold in all possible ways with S. Gamma 1, gamma 2 are the two pieces. You take the ratio of the volume of S with the minimum gamma 1 or gamma 2. You take the infimum, and this bounds from below the lowest mass of the would-be graviton. So they pointed out nicely that that's the only way something can work out. And this is, in a sense, what happens. Now, in a sense, because there are twists, here are the two basic twists. The first is that there is warping, so the real operator is not the Laplacian or the compact space, but a modification thereof. The fact that this is the universal spin 2 spectrum operator independently of any matter fields. You see, it doesn't depend on anything but the geometry, even though you have fluxes, you have scalars, and so on. This is, can be shown, it's shown in these two papers, actually, to be the case always. So there is a universal operator. However, it's not simply the Laplacian. It depends also on this warp factor. So I don't know if there are Chigger bounds or can be easily obtained for this kind of operators. I haven't really looked into this. However, this is one of the differences. The second crucial difference, actually, is that there turns out to be a second relevant scale in this problem. Here are the relevant scales. So there is the size of the two blobs of the compact space. Now, Thibault asked whether this is different from the IHES radius. The answer is no. Actually, that's the well-known scale separation problem. We don't have solutions in which you can really decouple the Kaluza-Klein scale. So this is of the same order as the IHES radius, same on the other side. In between, there is a throat, and the radius of the throat can be indeed parametrically smaller because it's controlled by the rank of the mediating gauge group. So this is your S here. But there is this new parameter, which I would call the length of the throat, and which has to do simply, in string theory, with the way the dilaton varies from one to the other side of the correspondence. Now, you may say, what is the dilaton? The dilaton in CFT is a bizarre thing. It's fixed, it's not free, but it's the ratio, in a sense, of electric to magnetic global groups, or the numbers of NS5 to D5 brains. So you can define it, but it's not at all clear why it should play the role it does. Yes?
A stupid question. Where the two IHES is linking? Say, if I think about IHES, I mean, you know, is this...
The IHES is throughout. It's fibered. So, you know, here it's basically, let's say, a constant radius IHES. Here, too, in between, it's fibered so as to make something that's like IHES5. Or more precisely, the Janus deformation of IHES5, where the dilaton varies also across IHES5 times S5.
You want to shrink the throat, right? You want
I am shrinking the throat, but I can...
Winding modes can be a problem.
No, remember, there is an S5 here, right? So it's not...
The moment you get the compact circle somewhere...
It's not a circle, no, there is... So there is, you know, this thing is an S5. It's six dimensions, yeah. So there are these two parameters, and now, the geometry of this throat is exactly known, so the radius is quantized, as I said, because it's related to the gauge, the rank of the mediating gauge group. In the pinching limit, the throat radius must be much less than the IHES radii, but both can be very large, so there is semi-classical gravity. Okay, all I need is the ratio.
Not sure, because the curvature is going to be much larger still. The curvature is going to be much larger.
Yes, but they can both be much larger than string or Planck scale. Okay, but the ratio has to be very small. That's all that I need. And now you can basically solve the spectral problem. So the way we solve it is by just doing the obvious thing, namely we look for a solution inside the throat that goes to constant values on the two sides. Now this is not a normalizable mode of the Janus or the IHES5 geometry. It goes to constants, but it is normalizable because the geometry is cut off at the two sides by the two radii, little L and capital L. So this is the mode, you can compute it, and here is the expression for epsilon. You see that geometrically it looks a little like the Cheeger bound, but it's a different power, so it actually is much bigger than the Cheeger bound. This is mass squared, remember, so it's the eighth power of the throat, so the mass is the fourth power of the throat over the fifth power of the IHES big space. But there is this correction factor which depends on delta phi, and which is something that goes from when delta phi is zero from 3 to 0 when delta phi goes to infinity. Now this seems to be something that allows me to tune continuously to 0 epsilon. Actually, the approximation in which we computed this does break down, however, somewhere before, when the volume of the throat becomes of the same order as the volume of these blobs. So I cannot quite take it to zero, but I can take it very far along zero. Here is a different way to write the same thing, which touches bases with the Aharoni et al. Calculation. So epsilon is precisely 1 over c plus 1 over c. I retranslate translated now the geometric stuff in terms of CFT data. But now there is this effective lambda. Remember, there is no marginal double trace coupling, but I can rewrite it as some effective lambda. And the effective lambda is the product of two things, you see. There is n, which is the mediating rank, n squared over c. So this can be very small. And this simply tells you that the degrees of freedom mediating the interaction are much less than the degrees of freedom on the two universes. And this parametrically suppresses epsilon. And then there is always this second thing that has to do with the dilaton variation. So one is a discrete, the other is a continuous parametric way to take lambda to zero and hence to decouple these two CFTs.
And where is the curvature in Planck units?
The curvature, I repeat, all curvatures are much bigger than Planck. What is the curvature in terms of what? No, but the L, you know, curvature is 1 over L. Wherever you see L, the inverse is curvature. All these cells are sufficiently big.
In units of Planck unit, we need to in Planck units, right?
Yeah, yeah, but...
I suspect it will also be n squared over c.
No, it's not, let's discuss it afterwards. No, no, there is no problem with this. I mean, the whole geometry is large semi-classical because the only thing that enters are, I repeat, these relative scales. You don't care, you can blow up the thing, you know, just multiply all the brains in this configuration by an arbitrarily large factor. It's the same geometry, except that all the scales are blown up. Let's talk, Zohar, let's talk about it in the break, if you don't mind. So this is the embedding. Now, I have just one last comment, so which in a sense, is comforting because it fits with expectations in a rather interesting way, but it also shows the limitations of what we have done. Let me go back to effective field theory. Now, the mass I'm talking about is always much less than the IHES radius, right? I mean the inverse, sorry, there's a minus one, because m times L is square root epsilon, that's very small. So the meaning of effective field theory is not very clear. I mean, the Compton wavelength of the graviton is super horizon. It's not totally clear what one means by effective field theory. But there is a restricted sense in which one can talk about this still. Namely, just look at the nonlinear Stueckelberg action of these coupled metrics and see when does strong coupling set in. That's how the limitation of effective field theory was derived in way in the other case. If you do this, you get the same cutoff intermediate scale, except one power of the graviton mass is replaced by one over the radius of ADS. This is in this paper of Deram et al. So there is clearly a cutoff scale which is in between the Planck scale and the graviton mass in units of ADS radius. If I translate this to scaling dimensions, basically, what this tells me is that if I have a spin 2 operator with scaling dimension epsilon, anomalous scaling dimension epsilon, then I should have a breakdown of my theory. Something should happen at anomalous scaling dimensions epsilon times c to the 1/3. Okay, that's just a simple translation of this bound. Now, there are good reasons to believe that this is something that should happen there. By the way, this scale, you see, is of course much bigger than epsilon, both because there is C, which is large, and because it's epsilon to the 1/3. But I'm assuming for now that it's much smaller than 1, which is the Kaluza-Klein scale or the multiparticle bound state. So it's somewhere in between. Now, there are arguments, no real proof actually, but arguments that this breakdown is a severe one in the sense that it cannot be corrected by putting extra scalars, vectors, or fermions. You have to go to higher spins. And if this is true, it means that you should find the condensing tower of higher spin 2 operators when you try to take epsilon to zero that arrives before or the latest at these scaling dimensions. So you can look at the problem, hold C fixed.
But since you erased, I just want to be precise. Well, what do you mean exactly by including the whole high spin towers? For UV completeness?
What I'm saying, here, of course, we want some UV complete theory. So what I'm saying, you know, if one was powerful enough, one could ask this as a conformal bootstrap question. What I'm saying is there is a spin 2 operator with a parametrically small scaling dimension that I can take to zero. And I'm asking what happens in the limit. So the limit, there's good reason to believe this limit is singular.
Okay, in this particular.
Okay, yeah.
In the bulk, the length scale linked to this E star is what it's compared to LEDS. It's
here it is. So it's the mass of the graviton, the mass of Planck over LEDS to the 1/3.
I know, but if I take Hubble,
keep everything fixed and take little m to zero, so you can make it as low as you want. I mean, that's the whole point. So there is a singularity in the limit of m going to zero.
That you see at physical length.
Yes.
I mean, if we do phenomenology, just to understand, or is it beyond the horizon?
No, it's at arbitrarily short scales if I take continuously the mass.
In your theory, epsilon is m squared over c?
Say again.
In your theory, epsilon is n squared over c, is it?
Times this other parameter, here it was, right? So it's it's n squared over c, but it's multiplied by this thing.
How is it possible to make it much smaller than 1?
Well, indeed.
I just mean in the next slide, go to the next slide.
Yeah, so n is quantized. I cannot take it continuously to zero if I keep c fixed, but I can take delta phi to infinity. And then this goes like 1 over delta phi.
Mm, so you need to take delta phi to be much bigger than n?
So I need delta phi large. I mean, of course, I can make it small by taking n over c small. But this is not a continuous parameter, but I have delta phi.
No, I'm just worried about the next slide, not this one. Next slide. Here, if you plug epsilon equals n squared over c, delta star minus 3 is always much bigger than 1.
No, there is 1 over delta phi.
Exactly, so you need delta phi to be much, much bigger than n.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes. Exactly. So, okay, so you look now at this limit. Fortunately, the full spectral problem in the Janus geometry can be solved. It was reduced in this old paper of mine with John Estes to Hen's equation. That's the next in the series of canonical Fuchsian equations after geometric. There are very powerful numerical algorithms to do it. You look at the spectrum and you discover, not surprisingly, that indeed there is a tower of non-BPS spin 2 modes that condense indeed with a power of 1 over delta phi to the square. These are basically linear Kaluza-Klein modes. That's below the breakdown scale. So in a sense, the breakdown is well taken into account in this calculation. Notice that these are non-BPS. All these are long multiplets. They are non-BPS. They are not protected by supersymmetry and therefore not necessarily visible in any weakly coupled CFT dual. But I believe that the generic effective field theory arguments are such that a similar singularity should arise in the double trace couplings. And it would be very interesting to try to understand it, because it may help us also understand these double trace couplings. So that's the end of my talk. I'll just summarize quickly. So there exist n equal 4, d equal 4 solutions in which the graviton has a parametrically small mass. That's part of the landscape. The dual CFTs interact via gauge messengers with controllably small leak out of energy. But the decoupling limit is singular, and one may ask if this is also the case for the double trace couplings. And the last thing I want to mention is that this very controllable communication between two universes may actually be useful in recent models of black hole evaporation, trying to understand the information paradox, because we can leak out the quanta, the Hawking quanta, to some other reservoir. And we can maybe do it in a controllable way, something we are working on currently with my student, Vasilis. So that's all. Thank you very much. And Now, don't be impressed, that's Google, but I was still perplexed by how, in going from Russian to Georgian, this middle name became one symbol.
it's a Russian tradition to put your father's name in the middle.
So this is not, so this is simply part of Samson in Georgian?
Georgians this like thing? To end the everything by E. So the last letter is E, so it's Samson E.
Thanks. Happy birthday.
Any questions?
Yeah, of course I didn't really understand anything, but why would one want to have a second graviton with a small mass? Is there any indication that I should go through all these complicated moves to end up with...
You should probably ask this in Gregory's talk, I think Thursday, right? Yeah, because he will probably try to make contact with real world. I was here, it's so hard to deform GR that I think we should be interested in any possible way that this may be done. So that's simply the spirit, you know, that's a deformation of GR, which seems to be part of the landscape, and whether it's part of the real world, I don't have any wisdom or claim indeed.
So, if we go back to the beginning of your talk, the Ram Gavadatse totally good nonlinear couplings. So, would you say there will be these special couplings appearing in the AFT of this massive graviton with the master thing?
Yeah, I don't know. Of course, I don't know. It's a very good. No, we cannot compute the effective couplings. But the fact that there is an equal 4 supergravity makes them, if they are there, extremely constrained. You see, somehow the way I sort of try to think about it is that because I need the Stueckelbergs, I need an n equal 8 multiplet. So there should be a way to put together an n equal 4 and an n equal 8 supergravity in some way that reproduces maybe these DR GT couplings, but we don't have any computation. Yeah.
Did I understand correctly that in the large delta phi limit something breaks down?
Yeah, you see, what breaks down is simply our way of computing the result. Because how do you compute really the result here? Remember, I'm solving the spectral problem in the throat, assuming that it goes to constants on the two sides. The reason why this is the good leading approximation answer is because the norm of the state, I didn't show it, is governed by volume, of course. So it's, in a sense, the constant values are 1 over volume to the appropriate power on the two sides. If the volume of the throat becomes comparable, then this is not a good approximation anymore. So when delta phi becomes sufficiently large, it should break down, and it better break down because then we would be doing better than the Cheeger bound. Now you may say, well, yeah, but it's not exactly the same operator. Still, I'm suspecting there is something equivalent to the Cheeger bound for this operator also.
But later, when you compute the BPS, non-BPS states, you don't use this approximation?
This calculation is just the full Janus throat, so things go to zero at the two ends. They are normalizable states inside the throat, you see. So I don't... Whereas the other is not a normalizable, yeah.
You mentioned this application to evaporating black holes, so then you would put a black hole in block. Two of the ADSs. Is there some entanglement entropy interpretation of this throat?
That's a very interesting question, yeah. So, indeed, I mean, one way to think of this is you have these two universes. The entry and the exit of the throat look like D3 brains, basically. So you enter on one side, but then you exit on the other side. So it's some kind of warm brain, if you want. And now the naive thing you would do is just cut in the middle and apply Ryuk Takayanagi. It's divergent, but it is as it should be proportional to n squared. So, you know, it has the correct dependence on n, but I'm not totally sure if I should interpret it as entanglement, but it's a good question, yeah.
Okay, so let's thank Costas again.